Observational videos about engines, M47N 150 horsepower facelift. Oh, the crankshaft seized up right in front of me. He came for fuel injector diagnostics. In general, he replaced two engines. Up, up, garage racer, continuing the video. Observational videos about engines. Here we have a 320 diesel E46 from the year 2003. The engine is a 2-liter diesel with the M47N turbo, which was already used in the facelift E46 models. Before that, the engine was the M47 without the N designation. We call it Michael 47 without N. The key difference lies in their fuel systems. The pre-facelift version did not incorporate common rail technology, whereas the facelift version integrates this technology into its design. More specifically, the pre-facelift version utilizes the Bosch VN type, which refers to a high-pressure fuel injection pump that intelligently controls both the timing and quantity of the injections, thereby directly providing fuel to the injectors. Here we have a common rail system, which is now more similar to a gasoline engine. It features a rail into which the high-pressure fuel injection pump delivers pressure and electronically controlled injectors connected to the engine management unit. Essentially, it operates like a gasoline direct injector. This design allows for easier diagnostics and maintenance because it lacks the sophisticated high-pressure fuel pump that autonomously manages injection timing. Now let's discuss the specifics of the M47N engine. It produces 150 horsepower and is part of the facelift lineup. Currently, it's equipped with a chip, pushing it to around 190 horsepower. This version doesn't have catalytic converters. Regarding the engine's construction, it's a 2-liter unit. While relatively reliable compared to gasoline engines, it does experience more frequent issues than the 3-liter six-cylinder M57 engine. In its time, the latter was highly impressive. More specifically, the M47N is more susceptible to mechanical failures, such as crankshaft seizing. Interestingly enough, our mechanic happens to have an engine of this type, and I witnessed the crankshaft seizing right before my eyes. He came in for fuel injector diagnostics, and suddenly the engine, which had been running smoothly, seized up right near the first bay. It was quite a shock. He's one of our mechanics and used to be my client. In the end, he ended up replacing two engines. One he found at a salvage yard, and then they replaced another one for him under warranty. So now he's on his third engine. Now let's talk about the diesel engine's quirks. In terms of the hardware, diesels are generally reliable. However, occasionally there's an issue with the camshaft, although it's quite rare. This seems to happen more often in Western Ukraine where diesel engines are prevalent, but overall it's still relatively uncommon. When it comes to the components, diesel engines tend to frustrate owners due to their complexity. They're turbocharged, which makes them more intricate than gasoline engines. However, they lack features like vanos, variable valve timing and valvetronic, variable lift, which are commonly found in gasoline engines. So, in terms of the hardware, diesels are somewhat simpler, but their additional components make them more challenging. If anyone is worried about the fuel system, there is nothing much to fear. There is a booster pump in the tank, which typically breaks down once every 300,000 kilometers or so. Even if it does break down, the car will still start as long as there are more than 15 liters of fuel in the tank because we have a trunk pump. The trunk pump delivers more than 3 bars to the high pressure fuel pump, HPFP. If it doesn't deliver, then the car won't start. Generally, it delivers well, which is good. There is a filter, and the HPFP typically delivers around 290 bars at idle, ranging from 300 bars at idle up to around 1300 bars or up to 1400 bars with a chip, which is 100 times more than a gasoline pump in the tank. This HPFP is mechanical and driven by the timing chain, so it rarely fails, maybe around 200,000 kilometers. So far, none of our clients have had it fail, usually only when the engine is replaced. Then it is replaced along with the engine. Then, the fuel is supplied to the rails. For all diesels, such as M57 and M57N, they just have different placements for the pressure sensor, either in the front or back. The pressure regulator can be on the rail or on the HPFP. Generally, there are no problems with the pressure sensor, and pressure regulator issues are very rare. You might get errors or fluctuations, but you can replace or upgrade the system, like changing the trunk pump on the rail, depending on what diagnostics suggest. So there is nothing particularly expensive about it. The most expensive and common issue that occurs is with the injectors. Everyone hears about how costly the injectors are, but in reality, I see that clients' cars run for a long time, like 50,000 to 100,000 kilometers. And with total mileage around 300,000 to 400,000 kilometers or 250,000 kilometers, and the injectors work fine without glitches. If needed, you can find injectors at salvage yards for around $50 to $100 each. Refurbishing them costs around $100 each, and removing and installing them costs about $50, since you have to remove the intake, which costs roughly $50 to remove. Now let's dive into the operation of the engine. To function, the engine requires a fuel-air mixture. For diesel engines like ours, spark plugs are not included, only fuel and air. In order to regulate this, the engine control unit, ECU, specifically the digital diesel electronics, VDE system, controls the injectors. When it comes to air-related concerns, owners often encounter difficulties such as poor performance, the emission of black smoke, or other irregularities with their cars. These issues are typically associated with this particular engine design. The air enters the engine from the atmosphere and first travels through the air duct and filter. It is crucial to regularly change the filter every 10,000 kilometers, especially for turbocharged engines. This maintenance should not be delayed. Following the filter, the air is directed to the turbo intake. Although the turbo is not visible at the moment, we do have one. This turbo is typically of the bushing type and is usually a Garrett brand. If a replacement is needed, a new turbo can cost approximately $800. However, if refurbishing is possible, it may range between $150 to $200 or up to $300 depending on the condition of the impeller and other factors. The air is then directed into the turbocharger, which is designed with a complex structure consisting of two shafts. To fully comprehend the turbocharger's components, let's take a closer look at its composition. It consists of two shafts. However, this design can pose certain issues. One major problem is the potential wear and tear of the turbo shaft, which can lead to longitudinal play. As a result, oil might begin to leak into both the intake and exhaust systems, causing significant harm. This urgently requires the turbo to be repaired, as it severely hampers the engine's power output, a notable issue on its own. Moreover, in some instances, the misalignment of the shaft can be so extreme that the impeller collides with both the cold and hot sections of the turbine housing, resulting in scraping noises. An alarming situation that needs to be addressed promptly due to the potential dangers involved. The turbocharger's variable geometry can cause early or delayed boost. The geometry of the turbocharger is controlled by an actuator that responds to changes in vacuum pressure. Essentially, the actuator adjusts the geometry of the turbocharger through a vacuum-operated valve with a lever. By pulling the lever, you can set the variable geometry for different levels of performance. When the variable geometry is set for minimal performance, the hot side of the turbine allows exhaust gases to bypass and spin up at a minimum. This results in little boost. On the other hand, when the variable geometry is set for maximum performance, the hot side gets hit by high velocity gases, leading to early boost. There is also an intermediate mode between the minimal and maximum performance settings. This vacuum-controlled actuator, which is connected to the geometry, responds to changes in vacuum pressure. The actuator operates as a valve and is connected to a hose. When vacuum pressure is applied, the valve opens, and when the pressure is released, the valve closes. This setup allows for both maximum and minimum turbo performance, depending on the chosen variable geometry setting. In addition to the actuator and valve setup, there is a pressure regulator for the turbo that often utilizes a Pierberg valve. This pressure regulator is visible and the vacuum from it goes to the actuator. The vacuum is also routed through an accumulator, which acts as a reservoir to store vacuum. There is a tube that runs alongside the engine and connects to the central vacuum manifold. This setup powers the brake booster, VUT, which is a unit that relies on vacuum pressure for precise braking. Diesel engines, unlike gasoline engines, lack a throttle and cannot create vacuum directly. Therefore, the vacuum reservoir is relied upon for precise braking in diesel vehicles. It's worth noting that diesel engines are less sensitive to air-fuel mixtures and operate consistently. So there's a vacuum pump. It supplies the main vacuum line, which leads to the vacuum booster. From there, it connects to vacuum regulators. One of these regulators controls the vacuum hoses. One of these hoses goes to the turbocharger pressure regulator. Depending on the turbocharger pressure regulator, this video is turning into a diesel engine principles discussion. Interesting. Okay, we'll film such a video someday. All right. Now, let's talk about the turbocharger pressure regulator. It's controlled by its own management system. It receives a square wave signal. Yes, it needs to be connected. Depending on the signal frequency, it opens. Its shaft moves to allow vacuum flow. Next, air passes through the turbocharger. Assuming everything works correctly, the turbo compresses the air and it flows through the piping. The piping should be intact. It then goes through the intercooler. From the intercooler, the charge pipe connects to the intake. That's where it enters. But what if the turbo isn't boosting? Common issues. Check the vacuum hoses from the main vacuum manifold to the vacuum accumulator and the pressure regulator. Also, ensure the connection from the pressure regulator to the actuator and the turbocharger is intact. The vacuum hoses should be in good condition. The vacuum strength itself should be good from the vacuum pump. That's the second point. Thirdly, if everything is normal, check for boost leaks. Boost pressure might be escaping somewhere. In other words, the turbocharger is functioning well and the pressure regulator is working, but the boost is insufficient. In general, inspect all potential leaks. If there are no leaks, consider replacing the pressure regulator. It's not straightforward to test, but it's better to replace it every 100,000 kilometers or every 300,000 kilometers. Typically, they last around 300,000 kilometers, so it's best to replace it with a new one. The original Pierberg valve costs around $75. Renewing all vacuum hoses is advisable. Replace the pressure regulator. Startup issues might be due to soot contamination from the EGR system. We usually recommend removing the EGR to prevent soot buildup during startup. Additionally, the vanes can get stuck or seize, so we remove the swirl flaps as well to ensure they don't obstruct the airflow. If everything appears to be in good condition, the next option to consider is focusing on the turbocharger. It is advisable to remove the turbocharger and send it to a specialized facility. They'll assess whether it's leaking oil, check the geometry, and perform tests. Turbocharger service centers have geometry testing stands. Sometimes someone might have adjusted the geometry incorrectly. There's an adjustment nut. It could be misaligned or worn out. Various factors can affect the geometry. Therefore, it's best to remove the turbo and have the experts evaluate its condition. This is one of the reasons. Now regarding the turbos, as we discussed earlier, repair costs can range from $150 to $300. Replacing hoses and checking the intake is relatively inexpensive, usually a couple of $100 up to the turbo. We once performed a comprehensive diagnostic for a client, which cost around a few $100s. Interestingly, it turned out that the turbo was originally from a 3-liter diesel, but installed on a 2.5-liter diesel with an M57 engine. This relates to boost. Let's talk about why you might encounter issues. You're familiar with how it operates and understand the entire chain. There's nothing overly complex here. The engine control unit's ECUs typically don't fail. Wiring issues are also rare. Now, let's discuss auxiliary components. Going from right to left, we'll cover them. It'll be easier that way. Diesels tend to warm up poorly in winter, and sometimes they experience idle fluctuations during cold starts. By the way, the 320 decoupe has an interesting feature. We'll try disabling it. It's an additional heat exchanger that can consume a lot of energy during heating. You can either disable or replace it. Usually, disabling it stabilizes idle during warm-up. So when it's active, it engages. Something else on the left is the pressure sensor. Rollers. These are part of preventive maintenance for the belts. We've already replaced them on this car. The coolant reservoir tends to crack. By the way, driving to Germany without a new reservoir is risky. In general, we've replaced reservoirs several times on these cars. The water pump fails occasionally, typical wear and tear. It happens around 100 to 150,000 kilometers. There's also a thermostat. Often this thermostat can cause trouble. It starts opening earlier. As a result, in winter on the highway, when you're driving, cold air comes from the heater. The engine takes longer to warm up, and cold air enters the cabin. The thermostat can also leak from the bottom through the gasket. So it's a common issue in the cooling system. It involves replacing the thermostat and the water pump. There are plastic hoses as well. They can break or develop leaks, so we replace those too. This relates to the antifreeze system. Any engine can have issues with antifreeze. It's not an exception. The radiator can also develop leaks, although less frequently than in gasoline engines. That's because the operating temperature is lower, resulting in less pressure and wear. So yes, hoses and water pumps can fail, and plastic hoses can leak. Regarding the engines, they are not expensive. Interestingly, this engine costs more than the six-cylinder one. The six-cylinder engine costs around $300 to $400, while this one is around $400 to $500. However, the six-cylinder engines are more reliable. As for the auxiliary components, there's also a torsional vibration damper in addition to the rollers. The torsional vibration damper is here, by the way, and it has been replaced. The damper is for the crankshaft pulley. It's a rubber damper. The rubber can vibrate, deteriorate, and crack. As a result, it affects the engine's behavior. The cost is around $150 to $200, depending on the situation. On diesel engines, internals rarely break. However, the auxiliary components can be relatively expensive. Specifically, the pulley is usually costly, while the thermostat is more affordable. The turbocharger and injectors are also expensive. So overall, the other internals are not particularly pricey. Now let's wrap up the engine overview. Regarding fuel consumption with a chip, you can expect around 6.5 liters per 100 kilometers on the highway. And without a chip, it's approximately 8 liters or more in the city. This data is based on a manual transmission for this owner. The engine is a 2-liter diesel 320d. It is undoubtedly in good choice. Personally, I would tend towards a 3-liter engine. If you are willing to invest some money, you might consider chipping it for more power. This modification delivers an added punch that I really enjoy. Nevertheless, for the majority of BMW owners and drivers, even the 2-liter engine with a chip is more than sufficient. That is why we highly recommend it for purchase. The 320d is a reliable and efficient choice for those who are unable to find a satisfactory 3-liter engine, whether it be gasoline or diesel. All in all, it can be considered a people's car. Please feel free to share your thoughts on which engine or body type you would like to see in the next review. Now, it's time to head off to work. Don't forget to like and follow us on Instagram.